Random House Audio presents The All-Girl Filling Station's Last Reunion, written and read by Fannie Flagg. Pulaski, Wisconsin, June 28, 2010. A few years ago, if someone had told me that I would be at this reunion today, I wouldn't have believed them in a million years. And yet, here I am. Mrs. Earle, Poole, Jr. Prologue. The Beginning. Lwów, Poland. April 1, 1909. In the year 1908, Stanislaw Ludwik Jerdobolinski, a tall, raw-boned boy of 14, was facing a future of uncertainty. Life in Poland under Russian rule was bleak and dangerous. Polish men and boys were being conscripted to serve in the Tsar's army, and in an attempt to destroy Polish unity, Catholics and priests had been jailed for anti-Russian sentiments. Churches were shut down, and Stanislaw's father and three uncles had been sent to prison camps for speaking out. But with encouragement from his older brother, Vincent, who had escaped Poland 5 years earlier, Stanislaw arrived in New York with nothing but the ill-fitting plaid woolen suit he was wearing, a photograph of his mother and sisters, and the promise of a job. With the help of a Polish stevedore who he had befriended on the ship, he managed to hop a freight train. 5 days later, Stanislaw arrived on his brother's doorstep in Chicago, excited and ready to begin his brand new life. He had been told that in America, if you worked hard, anything was possible. A Most Unusual Week. Point Clear, Alabama, Monday, June 6, 2005. 76 degrees and sunny. Mrs. Earle Poole, Jr., better known to friends and family as Sookie, was driving home from the Birds R Us store out on Highway 98 with one 10-pound bag of sunflower seeds and one 10-pound bag of wild bird seed, and not her usual weekly purchase for the past 15 years of one 20-pound bag of the Pretty Boy wild bird seed and sunflower mix. As she had explained to Mr. Nadelshaft, she was worried that the smaller birds were not getting enough to eat. Every morning lately, the minute she filled her feeders, the larger, more aggressive blue jays would swoop in and scare the little birds all away. She noticed that the blue jays always ate the sunflower seeds first, and so tomorrow she was going to try putting just plain sunflower seeds in her backyard feeders, and while the blue jays were busy eating them, she would run around the house as fast as she could and put the wild bird seed in the feeders in the front yard. That way, her poor finches and titmice might be able to get a little something at least. As she drove over the Mobile Bay Bridge, she looked out at the big, white, puffy clouds and saw a long row of pelicans flying low over the water. The bay was sparkling in the bright sun and already dotted with red, white, and blue sailboats headed out for the day. A few people fishing alongside the bridge waved as she passed by, and she smiled and waved back. She was almost to the other side when she suddenly began to experience some sort of a vague and unusual sense of well-being, and with good reason. Against all odds, she had just survived the last wedding of their three daughters, Dee Dee, Cece, and Lily. Their only unmarried child now was their 25-year-old son, Carter, who lived in Atlanta, and some other poor God help her beleaguered mother of the bride would be in charge of planning that happy occasion. All she and Earle would have to do for Carter's wedding was to show up and smile. And today, other than one short stop at the bank and picking up a couple of pork chops for dinner, she didn't have another single thing she had to do. She was almost giddy with relief. Of course, Sookie absolutely worshipped and adored her girls, but having to plan 3 large weddings in fewer than 2 years had been a grueling, never-ending 24 hours a day job, with all the bridal showers, picking out patterns, shopping, fittings, writing invitations, meeting with caterers, figuring out seating arrangements, ordering flowers. And between dealing with the out-of-town guests and new in-laws, figuring out where to put everyone, plus last-minute bridal hysteria, at this point, she was simply weddinged out. And no wonder. If you counted Dee Dee's last one, technically there really had been 4 large weddings, which meant shopping and being fitted for 4 different mother-of-the-bride dresses. You can't wear the same one twice in less than 2 years. Dee Dee had married and then promptly divorced, and after they had spent weeks returning all the wedding gifts, she had turned around and remarried the exact same husband. Her second wedding hadn't been quite as expensive as the first, but every bit as stressful. When she and Earle had married in 1968, it had been just a typical church affair. White wedding gown, bridesmaids in matching pastel dresses and shoes, ring bearer, best man, reception, over and out. But now, everybody had to have some kind of a theme. Dee Dee had insisted on having an authentic Old South Gone with the Wind wedding, complete with a Scarlett O'Hara dress, large hoop skirt and all, and at the last minute she had to be driven to the church standing up in the back of a small moving van. Lily and her groom wanted an entirely red and white wedding, including the invitations, food, drinks, and all the decorations in honor of the University of Alabama football team. And Cece, Lily's twin sister, the last girl to marry, had carried her 10-pound Persian cat, Peekaboo, down the aisle instead of a wedding bouquet. And the groom's German shepherd, dressed in a tux, had served as best man. And if that wasn't bad enough, someone's turtle was the ring bearer. The entire thing had just been excruciating. You can't hurry a turtle. Looking back on it now, Sookie realized she really should have put her foot down when Cece and James invited all their friends to bring their pets to the reception. But she had made a sacred vow to never bully her children. Nevertheless, having to replace an entire banquet room's wall-to-wall carpeting at the Grand Hotel was going to cost them a fortune. Oh well, too late now. Hopefully all that was behind her. And evidently not a minute too soon. 2 days ago, when Cece left for her honeymoon, Sookie had broken down and sobbed uncontrollably. She didn't know if she was experiencing empty nest syndrome or just plain exhaustion. She knew she must be tired. At the reception, she had introduced a man to his own wife, twice. The truth was, as sad as she was to see Cece and James drive off, she had been secretly looking forward to going home, taking off all her clothes, and crawling into bed for about 5 years. But even that had been put on hold. At the last minute, James' parents, his sister and her husband, had decided to stay over an extra night, so she had to quickly try and whip up a little going-away brunch for them. Granted, it wasn't much. Earle's coconut margaritas, an assortment of crackers, cream cheese and pepper jelly, shrimp and grits, crab cakes with coleslaw, and tomato aspic on the side. But still, it had taken some effort. When Sookie drove into the little town of Point Clear and passed the Page and Palette bookstore, it occurred to her that maybe tomorrow she would stop in and pick up a good book. She hadn't had time to read anything other than her daily horoscope, the Kappa newsletter, and an occasional Birds and Blooms magazine. We could be at war for all she knew. But now she was actually going to be able to read an entire book again. She suddenly felt like doing the twist right there in the front seat, which only reminded her how long it had been since she and Earle had learned a new dance step. She had probably even forgotten how to do the hokey pokey. All she really had left to deal with now was her 88-year-old mother, the formidable Mrs. Lenore Simmons Krackenberry, who absolutely refused to move to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.